day. Thank you that he was born for us humbly, lowly, not with a lot of fanfare. He was born. Thank you, Lord, for his coming again, which will be with a lot of fanfare, with shouts of joy, and he will come to rule, and we look forward to that day as well. We give you praise and honor and glory this morning. And we pray now as we come to your word that you would teach us and open our eyes and show us great things about you and your son. In whose name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Calvary Chapel Island. Test 1, 2, 3.
Massive electronic issues today. As you can see, our camera is not working. I think we took a hit with the power on and off and on and off, so our camera got whacked, and so we're doing the best we can to record the message for those of us. For those of you who are watching via video, we're sorry for the poor quality this morning of the camera. But for those of you who are here, good morning. Welcome to Calvary Chapel, Quincy, California. Turn with me in your Bibles this morning to the book of 2 Timothy. We're going to be in chapter 4, verses 6 through 22 as we finish this book this morning. Now, as you know, if you haven't figured this out yet, the theme of the pastoral epistles, that's 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus, which we will study next, is church order. God desires that his church be orderly. And so God left us instructions to follow. Isn't that good to know? Now for 2 Timothy, the specific sub-theme, as it were, is hold fast to the pattern of sound words. That is, hold fast to your Bible. Hold fast to the truth of God. And the key verse for 2 Timothy is found in chapter 1, verse 13. Hold fast the pattern of sound words which you have heard from me, that's the Apostle Paul, in faith and love which are in Christ Jesus. Now chapter 4 concludes Paul's second letter to Timothy. And it contains the last words we have that were written by the Apostle Paul, written before he was beheaded by order of the Roman Emperor Nero. And as such, these words comprise his final statements that are recorded for us in Scripture. And again, the last words of any person seem to be important words. And these are especially important. So we ought to pay particular attention to these final words. Starting in verse 6, Paul moves into a series of retrospective verses. He discusses his impending execution. He discusses the state of some of his followers and his longing to see one more time his true son in the faith, Timothy, before he died. And I hope that as we finish this epistle, that we have gained a renewed appreciation for God's word. Amen. And if you're not already there, turn with me in your Bible, 2 Timothy chapter 4, beginning in verse 6, as we continue to fall in love with God's Word, and more importantly, with the God of the Word. Amen? In fact, let's read chapter 4, verses 1 through 5, just to catch up the flow of thought here. Paul writing says to Timothy, he says, I charge you, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready, in season and out of season, convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. But you, that is you, Timothy, but you, you church, but you be watchful in all things. Endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. And now we start with verse 6. For I, the Apostle Paul, for I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. So Paul begins to speak metaphorically about his death. He likens it to the pouring out of a drink offering upon the altar. And this practice is mentioned many times in the Old Testament. It's however lacking specifics in how this was actually performed by the priest. In Exodus chapter 29, verse 41, it says this. It says that it was an offering made by fire to the Lord. And this particular drink offering mentioned in Exodus 29, it was lamb, so it was meat with grain, and then a drink offering was poured over it. And you get the picture, at least I do in my own mind. You've been to some of those restaurants, right, like Benihana or whatever, and they pour the alcohol over that hot dish of meat, and the flames come up, right? And there's this as the alcohol burns off, right? You've seen that? That's the picture I have in my mind of a drink offering. You're pouring this wine over this hot meat on the altar, and this flame just comes up. And I think, in a sense, Paul may have had in his mind that his life, you see, was going to be fully consumed in the service of the Lord, you see? He saw his life as just going up in this blaze of flame and glory as he finished his race, as he fought the good fight, you see. Now, another idea about this drink offering is that it may be a reference to the means of Paul's death as well. You see, Paul was beheaded, and as he was beheaded, his blood, in a sense, would be poured out in that way. So that's another idea of this. You know, little is known about the actual manner of the drink offering, except that wine was used, and we know that wine is a symbol of joy in the Bible. And so we have to conclude that Paul didn't see his death as a tragedy. Isn't that great? He didn't see losing his life for Christ as a tragedy, but he saw it as a joyous event. He saw it as a celebration. He saw it as going up in a blaze of glory as his life was poured out, in a sense, on God's altar. You know, to give your life so fully to the Lord that it's poured out as an offering is a celebration. Amen? It's not a tragedy to live for Jesus. It's not a tragedy to even die for Jesus. It's a celebration. He also notes the nearness of that coming day. He says, in the time of my departure is at hand. And this word departure comes from a word that means to loose a ship from its moorings in order for it to take to the open sea. Isn't that great? Isn't that a great, another great picture? Loosing a ship from its moorings so it can take to the open sea. Paul saw his departure from this earth and his physical body as a wonderful trip. Isn't that great? A wonderful trip. And one day we all hope to join him on that trip. Amen? Now in verse 7 he says this. He says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. So Paul also saw his life in terms of an athletic event. And today, he might be quoted as saying, I left it all on the field of play. Paul left nothing undone that the Lord had given him to do. He fought the good fight, you see. He was there from round one until the bell sounded in the final round. And he was in the fight the whole time, you see. He was in the fight the whole time. He also saw himself as a runner, crossing the finish line. You know, the Christian life is, more often than not, it's an endurance race instead of a sprint. Amen? It's more often than not an endurance race. We must live for the Lord. We must run the race each and every day until we, like Paul, cross the finish line and enter our eternal home. Amen? Run the race. Run for the Lord. There's no time for slowing down. No time for sitting down. Paul saw himself crossing the finish line, breaking the tape, as it were. Do you see yourself in the race? Do you see yourself crossing the finish line one day? Are you in the fight for the faith? Are you competing for what matters most? That is the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what matters most, the gospel message. And lastly, but not least, Paul cuts to the chase, puts away all the analogies, and says simply, I have kept the faith. I have kept the faith. Paul was born again by grace through faith in the person and work of Christ alone, and he kept walking in that same faith. Amen? To the very end. You know, one of the early church fathers, Tertullian, he would not even add a person to the rolls of the church until that person had died in the faith. So you didn't get to go into the church directory until you finally died as a Christian, right? Try calling those folks up. But that's the evidence that we are believers in Christ, that we live our life for Christ. It's not that you never backslide, not that you never stumble or never fall, but that you keep getting up and keep going to the very, very end. That's the evidence that we're born again, that we never leave the Lord. As great as Paul was, he did not, and I want you to listen carefully, he did not work his way to heaven. But he trusted fully in the person and completed work of Jesus Christ on the cross. And so should we. Amen? There's no other way. No other way. Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, the Bible says, but according to his mercy, he saved us. Amen? We didn't save ourselves. It's not because we were good boys and girls. It's because he was perfect. He was the perfect sacrifice of God. Now look at verse 8. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who love his appearing. So after a life full of serving the Lord, Paul says, finally. You see, there is a day, a final day, that we have to serve the Lord on this earth before we die or before we are raptured. There is a finality, you see, to life here, and I think we all know that. It does not go on forever here. For those people who are one day going to get around to serving the Lord, that day may never come. There's a finality to life. But a day is coming. A day Paul already spoke of in verse 1 of this chapter and repeats here. The day of his, that is Jesus, the day of his appearing. On that day, the day of his appearing, that is the rapture of the church, believers will be rewarded for their faithful service. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 10, the Bible says, for we must all, what's all mean? All. So we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. And this will happen at his appearing. When Christ comes for his church, when the church is raptured to heaven, it will be at that time that God rewards you for your faithful service. Amen? You see, we stand before Christ at the judgment seat of Christ, not to be judged for our sins. Our sins were judged on the cross. Amen? We are judged for rewards. How did you serve the Lord? And rewards are passed out. In fact, that word, judgment seat of Christ, is the Greek word bema seat. And it was the same stand that the Olympic athletes stood on to receive the crown for winning the race, you see. So it wasn't a place of shame or judgment, but it was a place of reward for running the race, you see. And we're all running the Christian race, amen? You know, and each of us has our own calling, our own responsibilities, our own works that God has asked us to do, right? And those are the things that God is going to reward for you for. In fact, the Bible says that if you even give a cup of water to a child in his name, that you will in no way lose your reward. Isn't that great? That the smallest Christian act will be rewarded by Jesus. That's good to know, amen? Because sometimes we just think, oh, you know, I got to be a missionary to the farthest reaches of the world to get rewarded. No, you just have to do what God has called you to do in this life, amen? And God will reward you for that. But you need to be faithful to those things God has called you to do. And that will happen at his appearing when Jesus comes for his church. Now, Paul said on that day that he would receive something that was already laid up for him, the crown of righteousness. It's interesting that Jesus wore a crown of thorns for us. And in turn, we receive a crown of righteousness from him. And the thorns represent the curse. Remember, the ground was cursed. It brought forth thorns and weeds and whatnot. The ground was cursed. So Jesus wore a crown of thorns representing the curse. And in turn, we who believe in Christ receive a crown, not of thorns, because the curse was put upon Christ. We receive a crown of righteousness. We in turn receive Christ's righteousness imputed. That's a legal term. It means it is imputed to you because of your faith in Christ. It's given to you, legally transferred to your account. Your bank account in heaven, your checkbook in heaven is full of the righteousness of Christ. Amen? I mean, you can't exhaust that righteousness. You can't write enough checks to exhaust the amount that God has put in your account in heaven because of Christ. He took upon himself the crown of thorns, and you in turn receive the crown of righteousness. And it's already laid up for you. It's waiting for you. When you get there, you'll receive it. So for each of us, this crown is already laid up, already waiting for you, already waiting for me. And notice also it comes from the Lord. That's Jesus, the righteous judge. It's Jesus himself who hands out these crowns. And Paul makes it clear here that all who love his appearing will get one. All who love his appearing. It's based on a love for the Lord and for his coming. It's not based on works. Paul did not see his crown as a reward for his works, but as a reward for his love for the Lord. You see, it's all about a relationship with Christ. Amen? Christianity is all about a relationship with Christ. If you don't have a relationship with Christ, you don't have Christianity. Because true, real, biblical Christian faith is all about a relationship with Christ. So for each of us, this crown is already laid up and waiting for you in heaven. It's got your name on it, I guess. Hope you got my size right. Now, next, Paul moves on to some personal notes regarding people that he served with. Look at verse 9. Paul says to Timothy, be diligent to come to me quickly. Because Paul saw that his departure was at hand, speaking of his soon expected execution, he wanted to see young Timothy before he left. So there was an urgency for Timothy to come quickly to make the journey and travel to see Paul. No doubt Paul wanted to see his true son in the faith, and to pour into him some final words of encouragement and instruction before he was executed. In verse 10, he says, for Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world, and has departed to Thessalonica. Crescens to Galatia, Titus for Dalmatia. Paul says that he wants Timothy to come quickly because everyone else had left him. Everyone else was gone. In Philemon chapter 24, Demas is called by Paul a fellow laborer. He's also greeted by Paul in Colossians 4:14. But here, this man has forsaken Paul. That is, he totally abandoned him. And the reason is this, that he loved this present world. He loved this present world. Love for the world derailed him. Love for the world derailed him. It's interesting that the word departed here, as in Demas has forsaken me, departed to Thessalonica. That word for departed is in the passive voice. You know, it was in one sense done to him. He departed in a sense. He left Paul, headed to Thessalonica, because he had a love for the world, a greater love for the world than a love for Christ, a greater love for the world than a love for Paul. Jesus said this in Luke 16:13. He said, you cannot serve God and mammon. That word mammon means wealth. You see, you can't serve God and chase after the almighty dollar for all you're worth at the same time. You've got to choose. And you know, God may bless you. You may be wealthy. And if you are, then God gives you some instructions. We read that in 1 Timothy. God has blessed you so that you can help others. Amen? But you can't live with a love for money. The Bible says that the love for money is the root of all evil. It's not having money that's evil. It's having a love for money. I always, in my mind, you guys remember old Scrooge McDuck, right? Donald Duck's uncle used to swim in his money bin, right? That's a love for money. Guy was in love with money. You cannot serve God and mammon, Jesus said. And this is why Demas had forsaken Paul. He had a love for this present world. His love for the world was greater than his love for Christ. Now, nothing further is known about this man, Crescens. He's only mentioned here in Scripture. However, Titus was mentioned in 2 Corinthians and in Galatians. In addition, Paul wrote a letter to him, the Epistle of Titus, and we're going to study that book next in January. Now, even though Paul mentions Crescens and Titus, that they had left, it doesn't indicate the circumstances of their leaving as it did with Demas, and so they may have been on business pertaining to their ministries. We can't assume that they likewise loved this present world. Likely, they were simply on church business. Now look at verse 11. Only Luke is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he is useful to me for ministry. So this man, Luke, that Paul mentions here, is the author of the Gospel of Luke and also the author of the book of Acts. He was a companion of Paul and had apparently remained with him to minister to him while he was in prison. And it was usual that prisoners had their needs met by relatives or friends while they were in prison. And many places of the world today, that's still true. The government didn't pay for your meals and care while you were in prison. They just gave you a room with bars on it, and if you had friends, you were lucky and they brought you food. And the same was true here. Paul calls this man the beloved physician in Colossians 4, verse 14. So it's likely that Luke was a doctor. Now, the man mentioned here as Mark is assumed to be John Mark of Scripture. It was this same Mark that Paul refused to allow to go with him on the second missionary journey trip he took, because Mark had left early on at the first one. So Paul wouldn't take him on the second one. But Paul had obviously reconciled with Mark. Now this man Mark had also been a companion of the Apostle Peter and had written the Gospel of Mark from his association with Peter. And Paul now sees this man as useful to me for ministry. And this is a great example to anyone who has ever failed in ministry or failed in some aspect of serving the Lord, as Mark had. But this example shows us that God is not through with you until he's through with you. Amen? And God was not through with Mark. He had many more things for Mark to do, including, as I mentioned, writing the Gospel of Mark. And apparently Paul reconciled with him, and now Paul saw him as useful to the ministry. In verse 12, he says, and Tychicus I've sent to Ephesus. So here's another brother, Tychicus, and this guy is mentioned five times in Scripture, and he's always mentioned in a positive light as a companion of Paul. Four times, Paul mentions sending him somewhere to minister or represent Paul in some way. You see, he was a brother that you could depend upon. And I have a sneaking suspicion that God uses men like Tychicus, men and women that he can depend upon, men and women who are faithful and who will do the Lord's will and not their own. I think that's the folks God wants to use. He wants to use those who he can depend upon. We might also assume here that Paul sends Tychicus to Ephesus in order to free up Timothy, who was the pastor of the church at Ephesus, so that he could make the journey to come and see Paul. Now in verse 13, Paul says, "Bring the cloak that I left with Carpus at Troas when you come, and the books, especially the parchments." So again, notice that Paul names so many different people in his writings. Paul was a people person. He had many strong relationships. And this man, Carpus, is only mentioned here, but Paul knew this man by name and hadn't forgotten him or hadn't forgotten the detail that he'd left this cloak with him. Winter was coming, and we'll see that from verse 21 of this chapter. And Paul wanted Timothy to bring this cloak to help ward off the cold. And you know, you gotta wonder, surely couldn't he have sent Luke out to the market to get another cloak? You know, I mean, why has he got to go all the way across the Mediterranean to Troas to get a cloak? Well, it must have had some sentimental value to Paul. Maybe some dear friend made it for him. There was something about this particular cloak that Paul wanted to have. But more important than a sentimental cloak were the books and the parchments. And we don't know at all what these documents were, but they were important to Paul. And I think what we see here is that even though Paul was expecting to be executed, he was still alive and still interested in these books and parchments and what they would supply him. They had value to him for ministry in spite of his circumstances, in spite of his impending execution. You know, Paul served the Lord to the very, very end, you see. In verses 14 and 15, Paul says, "Alexander, the coppersmith, did me much harm. May the Lord repay him according to his works. You also must beware of him, for he has greatly resisted our words." So here's a man whom Paul warns Timothy to look out for. The name Alexander was a common name, and we find several men in Scripture with this name. He might not be the Alexander mentioned in 1 Timothy, but he may be. But likely this man was also an idol maker, like Demetrius was from the city of Ephesus, who, if you remember the story of Demetrius in the book of Acts, he led a riot against Paul in the city of Ephesus because people were flocking to Christ and they were no longer buying their idols that were made and all. And so the idol makers had gotten together and caused a stir and a riot to kick Paul out of town. So Alexander may have been among those. It says he's greatly resisted our words. So we know that this man was opposed to the gospel message and the teaching of Paul. Paul says that this man would one day receive the reward for his works, and that would happen at the great white throne judgment unless he repented and turned to Christ. Paul says, "May the Lord repay him according," watch this closely, "his works," according to his works. You see, those who don't receive Christ as their Lord and Savior will be judged by their works. And no man is perfect. So no man's works will stand up at that judgment, no matter how good you are among men, because you're still not as good as the Lord. Amen? And so this man will one day, if he does not repent, be judged according to his works. We who believe, we are judged according to the work of Christ, and our sins are paid for on the cross. That's biblical Christianity, folks. Amen? Now look at verse 16. At my first defense, no one stood with me, but all forsook me. May it not be charged against them. Now, in a Roman trial, there were two hearings, and Paul was on trial in Rome before Caesar Nero, and there were always two hearings in a Roman trial, the prima actio and the secunda actio. The first trial was to establish the charge. The second hearing was to determine a guilt or innocence of the charge. It appears that at this first trial, no one stood with Paul. And this may have been the result of the persecutions that were ongoing by Caesar Nero against Christians after the burning of Rome by Nero, which he then blamed on the Christians. Christians who were arrested at that time were often coated with pitch. They were set ablaze to light Nero's gardens at night while he drove his chariot around and around in his garden. They were also covered with the skins of freshly killed animals and then torn to pieces in the arena by wild dogs or other wild animals. So to be a Christian at this time was to suffer a horrible death if caught. But Paul did not blame them for not standing up for him at his trial. He said, may it not be charged against them. He understood the circumstances that were ongoing in Rome at that time. Now look at verses 17 and 18. But, so in contrast to no one standing up for Paul, but the Lord stood with me and strengthened me so that the message might be preached fully through me and that all the Gentiles might hear. Also, I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion, and the Lord will deliver me from every evil work and preserve me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever. Amen. So in spite of no one else standing up for Paul, the Lord stood up and stood with Paul. And you know, we often wonder how people can endure such great persecution. And here it is, right here. The Lord will stand with you. The Lord will give you strength to endure it. He did for Paul, and he will for you as well. Amen? Paul says, but the Lord stood with me and strengthened me so that the message might be preached fully through me and that all the Gentiles might hear. And we Gentiles, that is, we non-Jewish people, continue to hear God's word through the Apostle Paul, through the 13 books of the New Testament, 14 if you consider Hebrews, that Paul wrote, to this very day. Notice also that there must have been some question regarding the manner of death that could be prescribed for Paul. There must have been some talk of throwing him to the lions. But he says here, I was also delivered out of the mouth of the lion. I don't think Paul was talking metaphorically. I think they were going to throw Paul to the lions. But Paul, as a Roman citizen, because he was born in the city of Tarsus and had Roman citizenship conferred on him, was not allowed to be thrown to the lions. He had to be beheaded if he was found guilty. And indeed, that's exactly how Paul died in 69 AD. He was beheaded by Caesar Nero for being a Christian. And many Christians who were mentioned in his letters, by the way, were also martyred in about 69 to 70 AD by Emperor Nero, including people we're going to read about in a minute, Onesiphorus, Priscilla, and Aquila. They were all martyred in Rome by Nero about that time. But even though Paul was about to die, he was not defeated. In fact, he breaks out here into a mini doxology of praise at the thought of death. He says, and the Lord will deliver me from every evil work and preserve me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever. Amen. Or so be it, he says. And listen carefully here, saints. Listen carefully. God is not going to preserve us for this world. He's not going to preserve us for this world, but for the world to come. It says, his heavenly kingdom. And that's a much better kingdom than this world. In verses 19 through 21, he says, "Greet Prisca and Aquila and the household of Onesiphorus. Erastus stayed in Corinth, but Trophimus I have left in Miletus sick. Do your utmost to come before winter. Eubulus greets you, as well as Pudens, Linus," that's Linus from Charlie Brown, "Claudia, and all the brethren." You know, in this letter, Paul mentions 23 people by name. Most good, some bad. How many of us, when writing a letter, would remember so many people? Usually we remember a couple of close, mutual friends or relatives. But Paul, more than any other writer in the New Testament, mentions the names of people he knew and sent greetings one way or the other. Paul was without a doubt not only a great theologian, but a people person. You know, another pastor asked me one day, he said, "Can you be a good Bible teacher, a good theologian, and still be a good people person?" Apparently he'd run into several theologians that didn't have any people skills. But I said, yeah, look at the Apostle Paul. He's a great people person, had all these wonderful, deep, and meaningful relationships, and yet the greatest theologian of the New Testament outside of Christ. Here Paul greets a couple of these familiar faces. Prisca, that's a shortened form of Priscilla, and Aquila. He had met these two people on his second missionary journey. And like Paul, they were also tent makers. And so they connected because they were of the same occupation. And Paul supported himself in the ministry by making tents. And so he and Priscilla and Aquila had gotten together in that. I don't know if Paul led them to Christ or not. I think they were already believers. That was another connection that they had. But they struck up a lifelong friendship at that time. Next, he mentions a man by the name of Onesiphorus, whom he also mentioned in chapter 1, verse 16 of this book, in a very positive light. Other than that, not much is known of him, but what's known is noteworthy. Here's what it says. It says, "For he often refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chain. But when he arrived in Rome, he sought me out very zealously and found me. And you know very well how many ways he ministered to me at Ephesus." So this man was a servant of the Lord, and he was ministering to the saints, especially Paul. And according to history, was also martyred for his faith by Emperor Nero. Now the man Erastus was a chamberlain, that is, an official with the city of Corinth in Greece. He was also a believer according to Romans 16:23. Trophimus was an Ephesian who accompanied Paul on his third missionary journey and returned to Jerusalem with him. And it was this same man, Trophimus, who was of Greek descent, whom the Jews accused Paul of taking into the temple area, which was against Jewish law. And that is what led to Paul's first arrest. And you can read about that in Acts chapter 21. Now, I want you to notice carefully here. Paul left this man, Trophimus. He left him in Miletus sick. You know, many people were healed by the Apostle Paul, but many people were not healed as well. Not everyone, listen carefully, not everyone is healed, amen? I mean, just look at your life. You ever get sick? I know you have. Paul was a man of great faith, and Trophimus was a brother who believed, and yet he was not healed. And the reason, again, is that not everyone gets healed. And eventually, what you don't get healed of kills you, right? It's just how it works. We all know that. You know, more work often happens in our lives through sickness than health. Through poverty than riches, through famine than feasting. God is at work in our lives to perfect our faith. And so much of that work happens in the valley of the shadow of death, not on the mountaintop of glory. Amen? Because we all walk down here in the valley of the shadow of death more so than on the mountaintop of glory. And that's where God's work begins and happens in our lives so often. Now, Paul also urges Timothy here to make it before winter. And as we see in the book of Acts, winter was a difficult time for travel in the Mediterranean. Paul was shipwrecked 3 times at sea, according to 2 Corinthians, and once for sure in winter, according to the book of Acts. Now, the last names he mentions are 4 people who all had Latin names, Eubulus, Pudens, Linus, and Claudia. And these may have all been members of the church in Rome. You know, Paul made disciples and friends wherever he went. And finally, in verse 22, Paul says, "The Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Grace be with you. Amen." Paul's final words are a desire that Christ would dwell with us. Amen. Isn't that a great prayer, a great desire that Christ would dwell with you and that grace would be with us? Grace be with you. What wonderful final words. Paul leaves his friends in the hands of the Lord, commends them to his grace. He knew most of them would never see his face again, but Paul was not defeated. And the end of this epistle does not sound retreat, but an advance. An advance that was made as Christ was born in the hearts of many people named in this book. It was they then who went on after Paul to share the faith with others. And that happened over and over and over again down through the centuries to this very day. Because of their faithfulness, this work continues among us. Isn't that great? What a wonderful story. Because of the faithfulness of these brave men and women whom we read about in Scripture, we today have a living faith in a living Lord. And that's just great. And by the grace of God, your faith, my faith, our witness for Christ will then go to the next generation and the next generation after that until the Lord comes back. I don't think it'll go that long, but should it go that long, right? Our faith will be passed on down the generations to others. So we the church in the 21st century, we the church living in the last days of human history, we must hold fast to the Bible. Hold fast to the Word of God. We must not let it go in our generation. It's more important than ever because it is man's last hope to know the saving truth of the gospel message and what it means. And may God's work continue to be passed down again to the next generation through our lives and through our witness for Christ. So, what have we learned in 2 Timothy? Read your Bible, hold fast to its truths, and share its message with everyone you know. Amen? Amen. Let's pray, and we'll have the worship team come back up for a final song. Heavenly Father, what a wonderful ending to this book. What a wonderful ending to the life of the Apostle Paul as we read these things here today. God, we pray that we, your people, we, your church, would hold fast to your word. We would not let it go. We would not stray from it. But we would walk in its light. And Lord, we would have an opportunity then to witness for you, to be first and foremost witnesses, that our lives would be a witness for you. And then we would have the opportunity to share you with others, to tell others of the wonderful saving grace of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And especially, Lord, as we approach Christmas and all that that means as we celebrate the birth of Christ and the opportunity that that also affords us to share Christ with others. May someone in our lives, in our circle of family, friends, acquaintances, co-workers, whoever it may someone, as a result, come to faith in Christ this Christmas. And we pray this all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And everybody said,
amen,
amen, amen.
Thank you for the word. Amen. Let's go ahead and stand for one final song. What Child Is This? And as we lead up to our Christmas Eve service,